40 years ago, no one really thought about how they were going to be dismantled.
After decades of service, the four Brent Field platforms are being decommissioned.
We got NASA to come and give us a hand, and they were blown away with what we were doing.
We needed to be able to lift the platform up from underneath. It was never designed to be lifted in that manner.
In 2017, Shell set a world record when Brent Delta was lifted intact and taken away for recycling.
Shell's idea, which was a right idea, was just bring it in, the whole lot, as it stands.
Now it's Bravo's turn.
You've done it once. How are you going to do it again? And how are you going to do it better? And that's the challenge that we've set to the team.
So how do you turn 25,000 tons of steel into this? In a remote area of the North Sea, engineering history is being made. The discovery of the Brent oil and natural gas field in the 1970s had a crucial impact on Britain's economy. Now Brent Field has come to the end of its life, Shell is rising to a new challenge, safely dismantling its four huge platforms.
There's three main elements of decommissioning. One is isolating the reservoir, and we do that what's called plug and abandonment. So we basically seal all of the wells so that at no point can the hydrocarbons come out of the reservoir to surface. The next element is we have to get everyone off the platforms.
The final stage is dismantling, and the decision was made not to attempt this on site, but to remove the entire upper platform, the topsides, as one unit.
We lift the topsides and we transport them to shore, and there we dismantle, and then as much as possible we try and recycle. So in Delta, for instance, we're managing to recycle over 97%.
The whole Bravo lift has been streamlined to give a 70% reduction in preparation work.
We looked back on Delta and said, okay, it was a success, but how can we do it even better? So that then, when we come to do it for Bravo, there was less work offshore, so it was safer, it was more efficient, and it really meant that the overall removals part of the project was, you know, a step change.
We learned so much from how we lifted the Delta, and when we came to the Bravo, we changed tack slightly. We went for a slightly different method that we thought was better, safer.
Bravo is firmly fixed to its 150-metre high base. A new method was developed to cut it free without installing the steel bracing used in Delta.
To maintain both, like, the strength and stability of the platform, Shell and their partners came up with the idea of putting in shear keys. So this was done by core drilling into the concrete walls of the legs. This core was then removed and a 300-kilogram steel shear key was put in its place. Once these were all in place, a diamond wire cutter was then put in between each key, and this then cut through the concrete wall.
Shear keys play a vital role in securing the platform.
We've got the gravity downwards force that holds us, but the shear keys also help us from a sideways perspective. If we have any large waves that come through here in the height of the winter or in the spring, then those shear keys hold us in position and stop any sideways or lateral force.
Six reinforced lifting points are also installed.
We learned a lot from Delta. There was a lot of welding involved with that kind of project. On Bravo, we did the concrete lift points. So this reduced a lot of the welding under deck and, yeah, reduced the man hours too, so a lot less risk of someone getting injured during the work.
Unwanted equipment is cleared away.
We've been going around the whole platform bit by bit, and as you can see, the platform's looking quite bare now, and lots of things have been backloaded by vessel and gone back to shore.
The crew prepares to leave, or down man.
The down man process over the next week is all about making the platform safe and tidy in preparation for the lift. And so we get to a point where we have the what we call the golden chopper, which is the final chopper that leaves the platform. As the chopper arrives, we'll TPS, which is total platform shutdown. So we'll be in the control room, push the final button, and then walk up to the chopper and get on the chopper. And then that's us.
When people get on that final chopper and it flies away, that's quite an emotional thing. We are saying goodbye to an iconic platform here.
The world's largest construction vessel, the Pioneering Spirit, arrives at Brent Field. Its unique twin hull design went hand in hand with the development of Shell's single lift concept.
So as we approach the field, we slow down, and then we're balancing down at the same time, so going deeper into the water, because we've got to fit underneath the platform.
Positioning the giant ship takes 4 hours.
My job is to ensure that the procedures are all followed, and then I give the go-ahead for the next stage of the procedure to commence. From now, we are on a standoff position outside the 500 metre zone. The next step is to move in to close proximity around the platform, go underneath the platform with the bows of the ship, connect all of the lift points, and then the next stop will be ready to fast lift.
This whole operation requires very close coordination between a number of different departments. So one is the marine department, so the people who drive the vessel, if you like. One is dynamic positioning department, so the people that control the thrusters that keep the vessel steady. And then we have the ballasting department. So these are the people who manage and ensure that the ship's weight stays constant or according to plan, so it doesn't go left or right, up or down. And then we've got the people who manage the topside lift system itself. So the coordination of those four departments is absolutely key in this. And that's why they're all in the one big area on the bridge. It's a very large bridge, but it's actually four different departments working together.
Pinpoint accuracy is needed to avoid coming into contact with Bravo's legs.
In all weather conditions that we plan to do the lift, we don't want the ship to move by more than plus or minus half a metre, which counts for the wind, waves, wave direction. So that's all goes into the limitation of doing the lift.
Pioneering Spirit deploys cutting-edge technology to connect its lifting arms to Bravo.
The innovation of the dynamic positioning and the active heave compensation, which allows a ship that's moving in the world to connect to something that's fixed. It's impressive.
Boss,
how is that ready?
I can confirm we are within half a meter.
Yeah.
Lots of people coming down the stairs, so it's going to happen soon. There we go.
...25,000 tonnes is lifted in just 9 seconds.
There we go!
Fantastic. Very smooth, even better than Delta.
Absolutely brilliant when years of work come together and everything works at the time when it has to.
The final stage of Bravo's journey is about to begin.
Once we've lifted the topsides, that's the point of no return, because you can't put the topsides back down again. So basically we have a clock that starts to tick. We have to see fasten the topside so it's stable as we transport. And then we'll turn round and install the leg caps with the navigational aids. That has to be done, including a 32-hour travel window, all within a 72-hour period.
A 700-kilometre voyage lies ahead. But the giant Pioneering Spirit won't be taking Bravo all the way.
The Pioneering Spirit sails down from the Brent Field towards Hartlepool, and there we carry out a transfer operation where the Iron Lady, which is an enormous barge in itself, comes and essentially docks within the Pioneering Spirit structure, and the two vessels work together so that the Brent Bravo topsides will be landed on top of the Iron Lady.
The Bravo is lowered onto the Iron Lady by pumping out thousands of gallons of water ballast from the Pioneering Spirit, reducing the ship's height by as much as 18 meters.
Then all seas need to tow in the Iron Lady barge through the Seaton Channel towards the Able facility. Now, the barge doesn't have its own propulsion, so we need four tugs to basically maneuver it down this channel safely with the topside sitting on top of it at the right tidal conditions so that we can sail all the way in one operation, and then all seas will maneuver it in and moor it alongside the quay at Able.
The barge is just coming in, and we're trying to line up in the middle of the barge with that yellow stick. So the gentleman standing with the radio, green hat, blue coveralls, he's the barge master, he's in control. He's the only guy that's communicating to the four tugs, and at the moment they're maneuvering into the right place. We have to get this very accurate because we're going to install the bridges to bring the whole lot down.
It takes 10 hours to push the Bravo ashore so that recycling can begin.
Shell want to do things right. Let's recycle it, let's dispose of it correctly. And that's what they've done. They've come to Able and we've promised them 98%.
The Brent field's been obviously part of oil and gas history for 40 years, and now it's amazing to see it both first of all come on shore and then the way that it's been processed and essentially sent away again in smaller pieces to be recycled is already pretty impressive sort of recycling of history. And just being part of that journey, the final part of Brent, for me is like a massive like honour and responsibility to take it apart, to do that successfully, and to show the industry that we can do a single lift dismantlement.